Hello, everybody. So this talk is about how can you convert your Jenkins server to just a script runner, and how you can store everything about Jenkins and your build jobs in your source code. So a little bit about myself. I work as a DevOps engineer in financial markets software development part of the Standard Chartered. And what I do there is just basically run the builds and deploy software and manage environments. So who uses Jenkins? Okay, so as you know, Jenkins is the most popular continuous integration server. It's open source, and it basically focuses on building and testing software. Jenkins has plugins, which are developed independently from Jenkins. And currently there are two versions of Jenkins. Basically, one is open source, and another one is cloud-based Jenkins, which is open source with some special non-free plugins. There is a lot of plugins in Jenkins which extend functionality really drastically. So you can do probably anything that you can, anything that you can imagine with Jenkins plugins. I personally, in my Jenkins installations, I use minimal set of plugins because I found that the more plugins you install, more unstable your server becomes. Fortunately, Jenkins has a REST API. So basically, all core Jenkins functionality is available through REST API, and a lot of plugins have the REST API as well. Not all of them provide full REST API, so from a lot of plugins you can get only the basic information. So in Jenkins, on every page in the lower right corner, there is a link for REST API. So you can always click on that link and see what's available. So Jenkins has three endpoints for REST API. One, they're all accessible through that by adding /API URL. And you can use the three versions of those API returns. One is XML, another one is the JSON, and the third one is Python. So basically, the difference between XML and Python is, and JSON is huge, and between the JSON and the Python, it's minuscule. So in a lot of applications, people just use the JSON because it's easily passable. And if you look, if you basically click on the API link in the browser, you can see the API output. And by default, Jenkins adds a parameter called pretty equals true, which basically prettifies the output. And the output could be really, really big. Like, for example, if you go and check the REST API for job, which has multiple builds, the output will be big. But sometimes default output it's not enough. So you can use the parameter called depth, and depth and a number. Basically, the most deep level is, I think, is 3. After that, you can add more numbers, but no more results you will receive. And a lot of plugins, like I said, they only support like depth 1, which not enough information for most of them. So if you see that kind of plugin, it's easy to extend it, and original developer will be more than happy to accept your pull request. And please do that, because it's useful for everybody. So what you can do with REST API? You can basically inquire Jenkins about different parameters from jobs. You can get the configuration of jobs, and you can get configuration of the views and such. So in here, I'm just showing you example on how to use the request library to save the job. So in here, see, I'm doing the simple request to the API, and I'm passing the job name, and I'm just basically getting config XML, checking the result. If result is okay, I'm going to save it in the file. So you can use that code snippet to basically to grab all your job configurations into XML. And those XMLs, sometimes they can be really huge as well. And you need to understand that XML and kind of grasp the idea how the plugins configure themselves and how bits and pieces in the job description fits together. So in this example, it's pretty much basic, and a lot of things are not covered. Like, for example, how do you handle the authentication? Because in many cases, you have secure Jenkins, and you have to pass the authentication credentials, right? What's not handled here is job description. So you can basically use another API call to get the list of the jobs and list all parameters from job. So you can discover that yourself, but it's tedious because it's something new for you to discover. But fortunately, some people decided to create a Python library for this, where we basically discovered all the URLs URLs and different endpoints, different bits of information, and created basic library, so you don't have to do it yourself. And using that, basically, Jenkins REST API is used for getting information. But in order to push some information to Jenkins, like reconfigure your jobs or start the builds and stuff like that, you have to discover, you have to do a normal HTTP push with sometimes with strange parameters. So this is hard to do if you're going to start it from a start. And in Jenkins API library, it's already solved problem, so you can just use it right away. So here is the same example on how to save job configuration using Jenkins API. So see, it looks simpler in my mind. I don't know how, does it look simpler for you? So basically in here, we're just creating the Jenkins object. We use the Jenkins object, which is a dictionary object, which contains the jobs. So you get the job on line 11, and you get config from it. So the all plumbing about the HTTP requests and how to discover a job and where the URL for the job, it's all kind of internally implemented in Jenkins API. So as I said, Jenkins API basically creates a set of objects which are just containers for another objects. So Jenkins object itself, by default, is a container of jobs. And you can access each job as a separate object in it. And then Jenkins has the accessors to get the views object, which will contain the view object itself. And the same for the Jenkins nodes, for the slaves. And there are some other objects like build queue, fingerprints, and stuff like that. So that allows you to abstract your Jenkins instance. So instead of thinking about, oh, that's a server running somewhere, You just write your code and discover the hierarchy of your jobs and inquiry started and get to build results. So it makes it much easier to work with Jenkins from Python code. So this is example on how do you start the build using Jenkins API and how do you access the build results. So here we see it's the same pattern. So you start, you create the instance of Jenkins object, you take the instance of a Jenkins job, then you basically say invoke that job, and then you ask queue item to block until complete. There are methods to do the non-blocking calls, but if you do these, you have to poll Jenkins for the status. So for the sake of this example, it's just a blocking call. And then you basically, you ask a job for the located build, and then you take the details from that build from the object. So in here is just a, as you can see, it's very simple way to start in Jenkins jobs and getting the results from them. In Jenkins API, you can create, using Jenkins API, you can create Jenkins views as well. By default, the Jenkins has only one view type, it's a list view. Any other view types are available as a plugins, but unfortunately not every plugin supports the REST API, and some of the view containers, they are really, really hard to script because of the post. Basically, in order to create a view, you have to post a lot of data, and the data is largely undocumented, so it's kind of trial and error. But it's in Jenkins API, there is a way to kind of, there are endpoints there. You can plug your view implementation and create views from Jenkins API. So in here, see, we're creating the simple list view. And we just checking if that list view is created or not. So on view, there are methods to add jobs as well. So you basically using that code snippet, you can create views on the fly if you need to. And that's an example on how you can create Jenkins job. So basically this file, this is taken directly from the examples from Jenkins API. And in here it basically reads job XML and creates a job. And at the end it deletes it. So that's example on how easy it is to create a Jenkins job. So Jenkins jobs are XML. And it's in many cases, it's hard to look into that XML. So you can grasp the idea on how it's structured, but in my mind, XML is like it's their boss. You have to put a lot of effort to maintain that. So a lot of people were thinking about how to simplify job creation. So can you create the jobs somewhere outside the Jenkins generated XML and push it to Jenkins? So there are many approaches on this. One of the approaches is famous Jenkins job DSL, which is basically a plugin for Jenkins where you can write the job description, the job definition using some domain-specific language. And the problem is most of the domain-specific language, there is no way to debug it. And you have to install another plugin into Jenkins, which lowers its supportability. So another approach is to generate Jenkins job from some much simpler configuration file. So that approach is implemented using Jenkins job builder. That's a library created by OpenStack developers, OpenStack infrastructure developers. And what it does, it basically, you define your Jenkins job using a YAML file, and then you use the command line tool provided by that library to basically generate jobs on the fly. So here is an example of the simple job definition. As you can see that this is, I would say it's a basic job that probably everybody will see. And it's a job that accepts one parameter. It will use the Git, and it will run one builder, and at the end it will try to send email about the job. So this file is much smaller than the XML that will be generated by Jenkins itself. And here is like, it's very precise, and the defaults that's used in Jenkins Job Builder are very, very, very good. So in many cases, you don't have to put a lot of the parameters, they all be there by default. So if you need to write something, you just specify that parameter. So Jenkins Job Builder allows you to create the job definitions like this, but it also allows you to create job templates. So you can create a job template, you can create your own variables in YAML, and then basically generate jobs for each value of the variable. It also allows you to group your jobs into projects, so you can have different types of jobs grouped together, or different jobs belonging to different environments or different teams, so they can look differently. And you can group similar jobs as well. And you can use the variables and macros. Like, for example, I use a macro I created macro to configure the Git plugin. So in many cases, I don't include that Git, that SCM section. So my SCM section usually looks like SCM and SCB Git, because the URL is always the same, and I just pass a variable for the project name. All right, so it's, you can create much simpler and much more compact representation of your jobs. So in here, it's an example on how can you define the, oh, it's a bit small, right? So, in here, I basically defined a variable called branch, and you can see it has two values, master and develop. And then I use the job template to generate separate jobs per Git branch. So the result of the Jenkins job builder execution on this template will be, it will create two jobs. So you can, for example, you can easily create Git pipelines, so each of the Git branches will have their own set of jobs. So they can, you can run tests on each of the branches in parallel. In Jenkins, not a lot of people use job pipelines. Well, when I refer to job pipelines, usually people think about the job pipeline plugin, which allows you to create some kind of flow of the jobs. But in many cases, Jenkins can be used to create pipelines like this. And this is kind of, that's an anonymized example of the one of the pipelines I used to have in my previous job at Maersk. So this job is basically, it starts from the build and it does the preparation of the tests, it does the deployments, and it does it in parallel way and kind of it gathers the results and runs something else. So for example, the section on the bottom, the test component section, will run in parallel. So if you use Jenkins, and if somebody will come to you and say, please make me a pipeline like this, your estimation to create that pipeline probably will be a couple of weeks. Because it's hard. You have to define all the dependencies between the jobs, and you have to click a lot of mouse buttons. I'd rather not, because I'm a developer, I'm not a BPMS programmer who prefers to move something. And it's not very visual, so it's to test that kind of pipeline, it will be hard work to do. And then, of course, Jenkins, by default, it doesn't support joins. So you can create a pipeline which runs something, but in order to do the joins, and as you can see in this example, there are joins, right? So you have to install the join plugin, and there are problems in configuration, so you like it will not be very easy to create that pipeline. And as I said, it's no way to visualize it. So you basically you run the pipeline hoping that it will work, and so some of the jobs may take hours to finish, and it's if they fail to trigger something, it will be just you have to restart from scratch. But sometimes, when you created the pipeline, sometimes you want to restart just to run one build in that pipeline. So there are two options for you. It's just basically you either make a copy of the build that of the job that you want to execute, or disable the next job in your pipeline, which is. Again, you change in pipeline, and because it's not saved anywhere, you're basically doing it in your production Jenkins, and it's hard to do that kind of things. So in my previous job, again, at Maersk, we basically thought about this problem, and we thought, how can we move the pipeline plumbing into the Python? Because we use Python for now. We generated jobs using Jenkins API, all jobs definitions stored in the source code. So the next step for us was like, oh, we have the complicated pipelines, and we're afraid that Jenkins is going down and we will have to recreate it or restore it from backup. We'd rather not do it. And we basically thought about how we can use Python and Jenkins API, which is easy to start jobs in it, and how can we simplify the pipeline creation. And another benefit of the library that we created that now you don't have to go to Jenkins to see where you are in a pipeline. So you just run it from your PC. So you drive the whole pipeline from PC, from your local computer, and you can see the result right away. So here is an example of usage of Jenkins Flow. So here is a simple pipeline, which basically starts the hello world, and it runs two jobs in parallel, one for fast test and another for slow test, and then it joins them and packages, right? So in Jenkins Flow, we use the with statement. So it's basically we use the couple of context managers, which allow you to group jobs and include another context in it. So basically, as you can see on line 12, we create a serial context. We pass the Jenkins instance to it, and we basically say every 3 seconds for next 200 seconds, give me the proxy port. So what do we, and then we invoke the job, and then we start two jobs in parallel, and then at the end we join together on the final invoke. So in here, the whole pipeline, like if one of the jobs in here failed, the pipeline will not progress. So it's basically it's a failure. But you still have a bit, and there are no dependencies between jobs in Jenkins. So you can basically go to your Jenkins and say, oh, so my slow test failed because, I don't know, file was not there. Or somebody deleted file, so you just put file and re-execute that slow test again manually, just to test it if the file is in place. But then you can re-execute the pipeline. And your pipelines, they will be in your Python code. And because they are in Python, you can put conditions there. You can put loops. You can do anything with them, right? You can even create your code, which will kind of algorithmically will create the jobs in Jenkins based on some conditions and then execute them and then delete them. So you can do much more interesting things because Jenkins for you becomes just another API call. Because jobs are stored in the files, everything is in your code. So you can basically put everything Jenkins related into your source code. So now with that, you can basically reproduce the state of your software. You can reproduce the build as it was previously. Like I work in banking and we always have that requirement saying you should be able to reproduce the build how it was 3 months ago. We never done it, but that's a requirement, right? And if you have Jenkins, which is kind of customized by humans, developers always improve their jobs in Jenkins, your Jenkins state will be lost really fast. With this one, by using all those three libraries, you can basically treat Jenkins as just a glorified cron, which runs something, not even cron, but just execution engine. So it's just servers somewhere that you feed with the data and you can run it and you can get the results from it. And it's all together in your code, so you don't have to touch your mouse anymore, which is good for me. I'm a developer, I'm not touching my mouse. And another benefit is that you can store all your Jenkins configuration and you can easily reproduce it on any other box. So basically meaning you lost your Jenkins server and you're not worried about taking backups and stuff. You just recreate it on another box in a matter of minutes. Because all your jobs, how they're supposed to be and kind of drive those jobs as well. And you can create kind of, as I said previously, you can create a job runner which you can run from your code. And Jenkins execution can be part of your code. Like for example, you can use Kafka or stuff like that to run the distributed jobs, but has its own API. But sometimes you need something simple to run it on external server, and you probably, like, again, working in banking, you don't have the direct access to run something on the box, but you can configure Jenkins, you can configure the slaves on the Jenkins, and Jenkins probably will be running on a trusted box. So you can configure slaves, create jobs, attach them to the slaves, and then basically execute it from your code, which is kind of a poor man distributed computing. But it works, and that possibility is there. So that's links to the all source code that I mentioned in here. I'm one of the contributors to Jenkins API. So If you have any improvements in mind, or if you find a bug, I'm happy to accept your pull request. OpenStack Jenkins Job Builder, it's on GitHub, but it doesn't use the GitHub pull requests. So be aware, it's all Garrett. I tried to put some changes in there and I failed and I decided not to. Right, and Jenkins Flow is on GitHub, it's made by my good friend from Denmark. And I previously did a similar presentation for Singapore DevOps Meetup, and the source code for this was some different angles of this presentation are on the GitHub as well. Thank you. Any questions?
You had a big picture with all the pipelines going out and then converging again. You said that would take several weeks to make if you follow Jenkins properly. How long would it take to do with Jenkins Flow?
With Jenkins Flow, it's very simple to create this, right? You just write a code like this.
Yeah, but the previous one, like how yeah. long would you estimate the time would take to do that? Yeah, how long do you think this would take?
I can give you a prototype of this in a matter of a couple hours.
Okay.
Basically, in Standard Chartered, we have, like in my department, we have some jobs that have to run, like some test jobs that have to run daily. An original estimation, like original thought of the development team was they're going to write a bunch of the shell scripts. And I said to them, no, because to me, and that pipeline that they have to run, it involves about, like, it's a lot of code that needs to be tested, and it's daily import of market, and it runs for about 8 hours. It's not running in production. Production is much faster, but it takes a long time. So originally they thought they're going to create shell scripts, and I said to them, no, let's use Jenkins. Because the beauty of creating the Jenkins pipelines is that you can split each step of the pipeline into a separate job. And in many cases you can think about it saying, oh, is it a serial execution or I can run stuff in parallel to save some time. Like, for example, they have the part which requires deployment of the latest software, and that deploys about 7 or 10 different servers, which is, for me, it's a perfectly parallel operation. But to do it in Bash, they had to do it serially. And so some of those deployments, they take about, I would say, 15 minutes to do it properly. So by basically running them in parallel instead of half an hour, we just run them in 15 minutes now. And of course, because it's a Python code, you can put if statements. Like for example, for this pipeline, sometimes for some components, they don't have to load the new code. So you can basically, in your pipeline definition, you can put the if statement saying, if some condition is not set or set to a specific value, don't run that job. So you can create a really dynamic pipeline, or you can create job on the fly in your pipeline definition, saying, based on this condition, I know that that job probably needs to be there. So you can do the branching, and sometimes you can, again, in that time, they have to do a loop, because the same component runs with different parameters differently. So they just created a list of the parameters and run it in a loop instead of going into Jenkins and doing something there. So, and it's basically the whole code for this pipeline is just, it's a couple of pages. And basically I've done the experimental part for the Jenkins flow, which allows you to generate the kind of diagrams. It's not yet, it is in the master, but we decided not to kind of enable it by default because it requires some server to be running all the time. So it's just, it was implemented using Bottle as the simplest available Python framework, but you can run it as well. So it basically the Jenkins flow able to generate a JSON that you can feed to application to generate a kind of diagram. So at least you have some ability to visualize your pipeline. Not how it runs, when it runs, but to see the static diagram, how it's supposed to look. Have you done any mistakes?
No.
Any questions? So basically, using those tools, I customized Jenkins Job Builder to connect it with my build automation framework, which basically generates jobs for each of the feature branches that we have in the source code repository. So in my department, I have like 60 applications that we write. And it's about like 30 applications are using those tools to drive Jenkins. And that Jenkins instance has about 2,000 job definitions. So that basically allows you to work with Jenkins as a professional tool. That's it for me. Thank you very much.